Right now in studio is Maryland's Lieutenant Governor Boyd Rutherford. Lieutenant Governor, thank you so much for coming by.
Thank you. Good afternoon.
Well, you've been working on this for 4 years now.
Yeah,
you've been the point person for Governor Hogan, and today the state has taken new action in trying to deal with this.
Right. We're continuing to push through. You know, it's this challenge has been evolving. While we think we're making some headway, the fentanyl is causing the fatalities. 80% of all the fatalities associated with opioids is fentanyl. And we're even starting to see it in cocaine as well.
So cocaine laced with
fentanyl.
That poison.
Yes, and it's killing people there too.
So you've been the point person on this for a while. Before we get into some of this action that's been taken today and the funding and the dollars being allocated, which is massive in nature, what have you learned in dealing with this over the last few years, last 4 years?
Right. Well, one of the things we set out to do was to make more people aware of the issue. I can tell you that when the governor and I were campaigning now, I guess 5 years ago, and we would talk about the fact that more people were dying from opioid overdoses, heroin overdoses, than, you know, car accidents or homicides. People were surprised to hear that, and particularly outside of Baltimore. And, you know, I was in Montgomery County and said that, and people were like, well, really? I said, yeah, look at the statistics. So the awareness has increased. The stigma getting past people wanting to seek help and family members wanting to make sure that their family members get help and seek out help. The whole education process in terms of prevention, making sure that younger people know earlier the dangers associated with opioids, with drugs in general. I've said repeatedly, virtually every third grader can tell you how unhelpful cigarettes are for you, but they can't tell you how dangerous it is to take someone else's medications. So we can start much earlier. Cigarettes have shown that. You can start much earlier in terms of the education. What we're seeing now and over the last couple of years is the impact of fentanyl. And it's starting to change the dynamic, too. We're starting to see more, because I'm in that age group, older individuals dying from overdoses. And what that is that these are the longer-term heroin users who now are getting fentanyl and they can't handle it. You know, your body breaks down as you get older anyway, and particularly if you've been utilizing these illicit drugs for a number of years, your body's going to be weaker. And then trying to use the same amount of heroin that they used to use before and they get fentanyl, it's killing them.
I think this conversation's hit a different level over the last 4 or 5 years in America, but the debate has gone on for some time, Lieutenant Governor, that what are the best ways to allocate our resources to get the maximum results? And you've broken it down, and I have the list in front of me, and the numbers are staggering, but tell us how the state is now going to allocate the lion's share of its resources in this fight moving forward.
Well, a number of the initiatives we're addressing. We're addressing, one, individuals who are incarcerated and coming out of the criminal justice system, in many cases at the local jails, including Baltimore City Jail, that they're coming out after a short period of time. When you go to prison, you go for a longer period of time. When you go to jail, you're there on average about 6 months. So if you don't address the issues that they have coming in, and if you talk to our correctional people, you talk to the local sheriffs, they'll tell you 60 to 70% of the people coming in their door have heroin or mental health issues or both. And so we're spending a substantial amount of money to address that, particularly here in Baltimore City. Also, prevention, the naloxone, you know, saving lives, making sure we get that out to the locals, and continuing with education. But a lot of money is also going into treatment facilities, expanding a facility, well, actually taking over a facility on the Eastern Shore, Poplar Hill, which was once part of the public safety jail system or prison system. We're going to now turn that into a treatment facility, a detox facility, as well as training for individuals who are suffering from substance use disorder, job training. We're supporting some other facilities that are like that in other parts of the state. The Helping Up mission here in Baltimore, I was there just a little earlier. We're helping them. They're expanding to a women's facility, building that. They're currently serving men, 500 beds over there. They're going to do the same thing associated with women. So we're putting a lot in the treatment facilities and then the recovery houses. Where do you go after treatment? In many cases, individuals have burned the bridges with their family. They shouldn't be around their old friends and cronies because that just takes them back down that road. But they've gone through some treatment through some period of time, and they are ready to be somewhat on the outside but not go back to the same environments where they were before. And so we're expanding support for recovery or sober housing, whatever you want to call it, that allows people to live in an environment that is supportive. They can go out and go to work during the day, but they come back at a certain time and they have, you know, counseling and other support services when they come back.
Lieutenant Governor Boyd Rutherford is with us here on WBAL. Looking down the road, and the day that Governor Hogan and Boyd Rutherford say goodbye in their leadership roles as at least governor and lieutenant governor, what will success look like in this? What numbers, what metrics are you monitoring?
Well, we are looking at the slope of, you know, unfortunately, we look at the fatality numbers, and we look at the slope in terms of how, you know, how quickly the increase is. We're seeing a slowdown in that. It appears to be peaking in terms of the fatalities. We'd like to see where that is substantially less, that it falls back below the other accidental death rates, like automobiles. So, you know, that's something we're going to continue to shoot for. And as I said earlier today, it's not going to be easy, but, you know, why are we here in these positions if we don't try to do the hard things? You know, sometimes politicians just want to do the easy things, but this is something that needs to be done, and so we're going to keep working at it.
The point was made in an article I just read, actually, regarding the border wall issue, which I don't want to get into as it pertains to this right now, but as far as, you know what, there's always going to be drug dealers and there's always going to be addicts, so almost why bother? What is law enforcement and what is the state's message to local law enforcement officials and the state police on this? And is that, does that also involve your overall task force right now that you put together?
Yes. We, of course, the governor and I support law enforcement as much as possible and all that they have to do to keep us all safe in society. But part of the effort is better coordination and getting resources to law enforcement so they can handle the drug organizations that are bringing this you know, danger and this poison into our communities, and those large-scale distributors who are moving large amounts of this to the public. You know, we do make a distinction between that person who's selling to support their addiction, but and those who are really making a profit and tearing apart neighborhoods and communities. And we do want to make sure we get those folks. And we want to interdict the drugs that are coming in. So it's coordinating with local law enforcement, state police, as well as the federal authorities and the Postal Service, as we had mentioned.
The Postal Service and how this fentanyl gets here. Lieutenant Governor Boyd Rutherford with us here on the Brett Hollander Show. And you have the federal law enforcement and also our representation in Washington. They've tried to take up this issue, I guess, but what is, do you see this as a fight for states, or is it something that really needs the help and the full weight to the federal government?
Well, we do need the assistance of the federal government. Just recently, they did pass what's called the SOAR grants, where we receive $66 million over 2 years that we can use for treatment and recovery services and prevention services. And so they have been working. The delegation has helped in terms of making sure that we get some support in that area. So it does help when the feds come in. What they can do probably a lot more, as I mentioned, the Postal Service assisting us in terms of the interdiction of fentanyl in particular that is coming in. It comes in from primarily two sources, China and Mexico. They're bootleg pharmacies or bootleg laboratories that are making it in some places, and it comes in, and in many cases comes through the postal system.
I see this as a multi-layered defense when you look at it. There's the front side, which is still, I refuse to give up on the idea that you have to explain to people, don't ever do it. Like, don't ever do it.
Exactly.
The first time could be your last time, and the addiction levels of it are off the charts. There's that, and then there's the realities of it afterwards. And we always look at the body count, which is fair, and the tragedy of it. And those numbers are insane to look at in our state and throughout the country. I think 2016, 70,000 overdose deaths in America. But that just is the tip of the iceberg as far as families that have been destroyed by this. and the violence that we see in our cities from it.
Right.
It's the tip of the iceberg as far as the body count and the destruction we've had here because of this issue.
Yeah. One of the things we said early on when we started on this is that we have to, one, stop the pipeline, cut off that pipeline of new users. And like you said, just getting that information out, don't even start. You know, don't start that. Don't go down that track. And then we deal with those folks who are, you know, that need treatment, that want treatment. They have to want treatment. That's one thing. But, you know, that want treatment. And then after they've gone through treatment, the recovery aspects and how they stay on that straight and narrow. So, yes, one of the things, like I said, and I'm going to repeat myself, we have to cut off that pipeline of new users. And that'll help us address all the other issues.
So final headline from this big announcement today, Mr. Lieutenant Governor. As you see it, we're talking about $800 million to address substance use disorders and ongoing opioid epidemic. And the numbers from the state's point of view are gigantic, I guess, for this funding.
Yes, it's a substantial increase, a 20% increase over the previous year's funding level, and that doesn't include capital investment that we're making in some facilities around the state, crisis beds in Somerset County, support for the Helping Out Mission in terms of their women's treatment facility, the detox facility in Frederick County. So we're putting, you know, our money, the state's money, the taxpayers' money, to really go after this particular issue.
Mr. Lieutenant Governor, thank you so much for coming in studio today. It's a big announcement by the state, and please keep us posted on all movements with this fight that the state and really the entire country is waging against what is a crisis and epidemic.
Thank you.
That is Lieutenant Governor Boyd Rutherford joining us here live.